You ever stare at your code wondering it's not doing what you expect? Sometimes you hit run, everything crashes, or the wrong data just shows up. You're not alone, this is universal for every developer. Debugging is often seen as this mysterious, intimidating part of coding, but what if I told you it's actually one of the most powerful skills you can learn? And Xcode actually makes it surprisingly easy. It's like having X-ray vision for your code. In this video, we're going to demystify Xcode's debugging tools using the simple demo app that I have here. And if you want to follow along exactly, you can grab this template down in the description below so you too can press the shouldn't crash app button and crash your app. But we'll be going through and fixing everything together too. So we'll fix some sneaky bugs step by step. So get ready to transform your coding process and stop bugs in their tracks. All right, so here's our simple app. We have a counter here where we can increase the number, a sum of calculations, and we also have a list of fruit. On the surface, it looks pretty fine, but when we run it, we see some weirdness. So the first thing we notice is the increment counter is going up by 2 instead of 1. Our sum of 2 plus 3 is equaling 6. That's incorrect, it should equal 5. And hitting the shouldn't crash app button, well, as we saw earlier, actually crashes out our app. So trying to find these with just print statements would be a little bit of a nightmare, although in this particular template, I have added some comments to help us out. To access the debug area in the very bottom right of Xcode, you can kind of see there's this square with a little rectangle filled in at the bottom. We can press on that and we should be able to see our logs, our console, as well as our variable view. And you can enable or disable either one of these by pressing on these blue squares. The right one is the console and the left one is the variable view. And we'll show you how all of those work. And on the very left side, when we do have any crashes in the project navigator, you'll kind of see this. It looks like a spray can called the debug navigator. We're also going to be using this later on. So knowing that these panels exist is the first step in becoming a debugging pro. So let's tackle our first bug, the increment counter. Currently, it's going up by 2 instead of 1. What on earth is going on there? So let's scroll down in our code and find where that is. That's our function of the increment counter. So to figure out why, we need to pause the app right when the increment happens. That's what a breakpoint is for. To set a breakpoint, simply click on the line number or to the left of it. This area is actually called the gutter, kind of like with bowling where you have the gutters on the side. And let's click next to our logic here where we have the counter. So for me, that would be on line 61. You may have also even created a breakpoint by accident, but you can tell that you have a breakpoint because it is highlighted in blue. So let's go ahead and run our app and we can see how the breakpoint works. So what we're going to do next is we're going to increment the counter. I'm going to press this button and you notice we pause, but we didn't crash. We have this green that says thread 1, breakpoint 1.1. Our app is simply frozen in time and this will allow us to actually inspect everything. So if we look down at the bottom left in the variable view, we can expand this window. Yours might also be set to auto or local variables. Or you can look at all variables and global statistics throughout your app. Generally speaking, auto is pretty smart. So we can see we have the Xcode debugging content view. And if we press on the drop-down menu, we can see that we have our counter here. Let's press on the drop-down menu once again. And we can see that we have the value of 0. So we can confirm that our counter is indeed starting at 0, so it's not starting too high. Now, if we let this line execute, so right above here, we can see continue program execution, kind of looks like a little bit of a play button. We can press this, we can see that our app has, you know, popped back in the foreground, and let's increment the counter again. And now we can see that our breakpoint has once again been activated, and we can see that the value has been set to 2. So that is our bug. It's currently adding 2 instead of 1. In order to remove this breakpoint, you know, once you're done debugging or you kind of figured out what you needed to, you can either right click, disable the breakpoint, which will kind of just gray it out so you can re-enable it for later, or you can delete the breakpoint. The way that I like to get rid of them is to kind of drag and swipe them away, and now they're gone. So let's change this counter to be 1 this time. Run our app again and let's verify that it works. Perfect, look at that. That was pretty easy. If you know general Swift knowledge, you probably spotted my mistake, but it's good to practice and learn how these tools work. Next, let's take a look at stepping controls, which allows us to move through the code. Currently, our calculate sum is not working. 2 + 3 definitely does not equal 6. So we can use our jump here. Let's go to our calculate sum function. Here we are. And yeah, this function doesn't work quite well either. What we're going to do is we're going to set a breakpoint on our let sum, so line 71 here. Let's go ahead and set that up. Let's run our code and let's see what happens. So this time, before we even got to see the phone screen, it actually activated our breakpoint right away. So I want to talk about these tools in the debugging area. So we have the continue program execution. So this just resumes the app until the next breakpoint. We then have the step over. This is kind of like the arrow going over. This executes the current line and moves to the next line. If the current line has a function call, it executes that function and returns without going inside it. The step into arrow, if the current line has a function call, it jumps into that function so we can see its internal execution. And then we have the step out, which looks like the arrow going up. This executes the rest of the current function and returns to where it was called from. So let's also take a look at our variables here. So in our variable view, we have A, that's 2, and we have B, that's 3. If you ever want to learn more about the variables, you can click on this eyeball here, and it'll say this is the name, the type, and the value. You can check out both of these. But let's go ahead, and now that we're on our breakpoint, let's step into. So this is going to allow us to jump to that multiply function. So here we have multiply. Let's step into again. And you can see our breakpoint is highlighting within the multiply function where it's returning A times B. This is very useful when you suspect a bug inside a function is being called by your current line. If we had this in another Swift file, we would jump to that Swift file as well. So it's not just for one file only. Next, let's step out. And this takes us back to where our product is, where we're calling upon that multiply. So we are correctly calculating our product, but we're not correctly calculating our sum. We know that sum should be A plus B. So let's go ahead and fix this error here. We can even remove our breakpoint, or you can keep it if you'd like, or we can just disable it. Let's go ahead and run our project one more time. We'll verify that it works. We can see sum of 2 plus 3 definitely is 5. And in our console, we're still printing that the product is 6 because A times B is definitely 6. We had determined that it was the numbers 2 and 3. I also want to show you how you can inspect variables with the PO command as well as the information button. So on our line here where we're printing what the product is, so line 73, let's add another breakpoint. We'll run our project again. We have our breakpoint pop up, no worries there. And you can actually write commands in the console. So in the console here where it's kind of highlighted green, if you want to know more about a variable, so in this case, our product, let's go ahead and type PO and then add our product. You can even see we get the autofill here to make sure that we spell all of our variables correctly. And we can get some information about it. It's currently the number 6. Another way you can do this is in your variables inspector, select what you want to know more about. So in this case, we want to know more about product, and you can press this little information sheet and it says print description. So if we press this, printing description of product, which currently holds the integer number of 6. You do this for anything you want. So if we want to learn more about B, if there's, you know, the items that we have here. So if we look at our items with our values, so those in our code are actually going to be those 3 fruits. We can print those descriptions here and we can see that there's 3 elements and we can even see their kind of location within that array. So you can use either the little I button here or typing in the console itself. If you want to learn more about those fruits, which were those items, right? You can either use that button or do the PO. And the PO stands for print object. So this gives you that immediate feedback without changing your code or adding print statements. On the left side of the screen where we have our debug navigator, this is like the how did I get here call stack. So this is a great way to kind of trace through your program how you're getting to where you're getting. So we can see here that we have different numbers, and when we're looking at things like the product, we can actually use this to track where we're going. So number five here, this is the content view. We can see that, you know, we're kind of loading in, we're going into that V stack. From there, we're actually going to the calculate sum, or we can press on zero to take us to our calculate sum function. So you can use this to trace in whichever order you'd like, if you like to work forwards, if you like to work backwards, how you're getting to those different functions in your app. You're getting to those different results, kind of how everything's working together in your app. So each one of these lines represents a function call. You can click on the line to show those code contexts changing. I also want to take a moment to talk about the view debugger. So I'm just going to really quickly get rid of the other breakpoints. We're going to run our app one more time. And on the bottom panel where we had our other debug options, you can see here we have a view debug hierarchy. It kind of looks like squares that are being stacked upon one another. If we press it, it's going to take us to another screen. Sometimes this might take a minute to load, but this is how we can actually get a 3D representation of our entire UI hierarchy. So right now it looks pretty flat, but if we grab our mouse and we kind of drag while holding down left click, we can actually move and see a 3D representation, even scroll in if you want, of our application. So we can see here that our apple banana cherry list is kind of popping out on the 3D. We can even click on different elements. You'll want to open up the right panel, so the inspector on the right side, then go under the object inspector on the right, and you can learn everything you'd ever want to know about your UI. So this is really great if you have things that are clipping, or your layering's a little bit off, the sizing is kind of falling off the screen. This is how you can even look at accessibility traits, the description, everything you'd ever want to know to debug your UI views can be found within the UI hierarchy. So we can even click on the entirety of the VStack, and we can look to see if the spacing is correct, if there's some stretching, etc., etc. But yeah, but this is a pretty cool tool. Again, so we can even see that, you know, the apple, banana, cherry, and things like that, they are popping off more forward on the Z-axis, and that they're in front of the background of the list view and in front of all the other UI elements. The size inspector. So if we click on this increment counter and we go to the triangle on the top right, it'll also give you the frame. So whether that's the X value or Y coordinate, the width, the height, the bounds, etc. So you can use this to really fine tune and see what's going on in my UI. Are things clipping? There are some additional tools at the bottom. You can even change the canvas color to test for light or dark mode if you'd like. Although sometimes it takes a while to load, as well as showing different constraints of the screen or even hiding any clipped content. And when you're done, you can close out of it by clicking the X on the tab there. Okay, let's go ahead and run our app again. And I want to talk to you a little bit about crashes. These can be something that is really intimidating, but with the debugger, they actually become a lot less scary. So we have an intentional crash in our app. The shouldn't crash app button, unfortunately, does crash when we press it. And you can see that Xcode actually automatically pauses here. It says thread one, fatal error. And most of the time it will give you an error message here as well that we can look into. If you're getting something that you totally don't understand, you can also use this to, you know, even look up on Stack Overflow. Why might this be happening? So our current error is that the index is out of range. So we know exactly which line has the problem, and it's this let item equals items force unwrap value of three. And you're thinking, well, we do have three items though. I have an apple, banana, and cherry. But if we remember when we looked at our variables inspector for our items here, let's click on our items. We do have three values, but if we print out what those values are, when we're working in arrays, it starts at zero. So 0, 1, 2, we never actually get to item three. So we can fix this one of two ways. We can either comment out the code, or we can change it to be zero. We want to start at the first item, which is apple. So up to you if you want to comment it or fix it. We can run our code again. Press I shouldn't crash app, and this time it actually doesn't crash the app. Instead, it's grabbing the item at the index of 0, which is the apple. So you can do 0, 1, or 2, and it will print out that item. So there you have it, from setting breakpoints to stepping through code, inspecting variables, understanding the call stack, and even debugging your UI, you now have the fundamental tools to tackle bugs in Xcode. Debugging is something that's kind of like a superpower, and the more that you use these tools, especially getting familiar with the step over, or the step into to kind of explore those different functions, or the step out to kind of navigate through your code. These are all tools that are very, very important when you're not getting the desired result, or, you know, getting crashes. Use these to slowly step through and analyze every step of the way. Check those variables. You can even print out the item description to make sure every step of the way it's functioning as you'd like. So if this video helped you conquer your debugging fears, please give a like and subscribe for more Xcode tutorials, iOS development tips, Swift UI specifics. Let me know in the comments if there's any Xcode tips that you would like to see. Otherwise, dream big, code bigger, and I'll see you in the next one.